day hoping to be off from work. An employer comes in at 9 o'clock in the morning and selects several men, one or two. And he selects his men and he takes them back to his farm and agrees to pay them $100 for the day's work. And then he comes back at noon and secures another group and selects another several men and takes them back to his farm. And does the same thing again at 3 o'clock, and then at 5 o'clock, when the day is almost over, he gets the final group and selects several men again. At 7 o'clock, when the day's work is completed, the men lines up to get their pay. And so the first group worked for about 10 hours, right? The second group, 7 hours. The third group, 4 hours. And the last group, 2 hours. So the foreman begins to pay starting from the last group. And they receive $100 for their 2 hours of work. As the men saw how the first group got paid, the word quickly spread back to the end of the line that the wage has greatly increased. And so the last group just calculated it. They're like, if they got $100 for 2 hours, that's $50 an hour for us. Because they've been working all through the day in the heat of the day, and they began to get excited. But when the other groups were processed through the line, they all received $100, just like the last group. The first group began to be frustrated and were outraged and said, we've worked 5 times as long as the last group. Yet they received the same wages as we did. And they said, that's not right. That's not fair. We should receive more. Calling the owner, the employer, said, what's not right about that? What's not right about your wages? You agreed to work for $100, and I paid you $100. What's unjust about that? The first group that was chosen tried to reply and began to think, but before they even said a word, the employer said, what I choose to do with my money is really not of your concern. As long as I'm just with you, I can be as generous as I see fit with anyone I want. Be grateful that you were selected to receive my generosity in receiving a day's work. In this story, we can identify several characters. The employer, the workers, and we can see that the workers all wanted work and need work. And in the story, we learned that the employer selected some and not everyone were selected. And he selected them in different times of the day to work for him. And that the employer promised the first group $100 for their day's work. And at the end of the day, the employer chose to pay each group differently. And that the first group were outraged because they worked all day in the heat. And they thought they should receive more than the last group. And so the employer reminded them that what I choose to do with my money is really not your concern. As long as I am just with you, I can be generous as I want to, whoever I want. You see, church, this is a story that gives us a small glimpse of how God decides who will be saved and how he chooses to bless them. And the question that I want us to think about this morning, and maybe you've asked this before in your life, is questions like, who will be saved? Did I choose to be saved? Why are some not saved? Why does God choose to bless the nation of Israel and not the nation of the Philippines? Right? And if you think about Jesus and how he preached on the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew 7, 13 to 14, he says, enter by the narrow gates, for the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter it are many. For the gate is narrow, and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. If many people in this world will end up spiritually lost and saved, how can we realistically consider God fair? Even questions of if you have kids, or now you're a grandpa and grandma, just looking back in your life, why did God choose to let someone in your family die and choose someone else to live? Why did this tragedy have to happen in my life? Why did my mom or my aunt or my dad have to have cancer? And questions like, why does God choose to save some and not all? Does that mean God is impartial? Does that mean God is unjust? You see, these are some of the most difficult questions that we all have asked or will ask at some point in our lives. Scripture says in John 16:8, and when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. He is, when he says he, that's talking about the Holy Spirit. And that the Holy Spirit is already working around us, convicting people's heart and preparing them to receive the good news. We all know what Jesus said. If you are full of fresh, maybe you heard this saying before, that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. And in John 6:44, he begins to say, no one can come to me. If Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. It is God who draws us to him. It is God that draws us to know Jesus Christ. And so as God's people, how do we respond to God's sovereignty? If we believe that he is God, that he is our creator, he is our savior, he is our Messiah, that he is everything to us, how then do we respond to God's sovereignty? How do we respond to the statement that God chooses to save some and not others? Will bless certain people, not bless others? This morning, have you ever wrestled with these questions? Have you cried out at some point in your life to God why he allowed certain things to happen in your family, in your marriage, in your church? Because it was opposite of what maybe your church wanted. It was opposite to what your hope was leaning on as a family. And it brought trials and pain. Have you ever wrestled with those questions and questioned God's decision in allowing these things to happen? My hope this morning is that as we look into Scripture for the truth, for answers to our questions, that God will reveal to us who he is. That God will reveal to us his purpose for our church and for you individually and for your families. And that he will reveal to us his sovereign plan. Because we sang songs about his faithfulness and that his word continues, and that is true. Really, when it comes to God's sovereignty, to most people and most believers, it can be very difficult and at times confusing to understand. You see, God's sovereignty is one of the most important principles in Christian theology. If you are a follower of Christ, understanding God's sovereignty is crucial for you to continue to follow him and serve him. God's sovereignty is a natural consequence of his omniscience, meaning the state of having total knowledge, the quality of knowing everything. God knows everything. Not only that, he's omnipotent, meaning all, meaning potent, meaning power, that he has power of all things. And lastly, he's omnipresence. Again, all, so to say that God is omnipresent, that God is everywhere, that he could be here in Houston, Texas, and he could be in Bangladesh, He could be in Neptune if he wants to. He could be anywhere he desires to be. That is the God we serve. You see, what people and theologians have disagreed on is really to what extent God applies his sovereignty. Specifically, how much he exerts his control over the will of men and women. You see, when we speak of God's sovereignty, we mean he rules the universe. But then the debate again begins over when and where his control is direct and indirect. When does he give us free will? When does he not? That is the debate. This morning, as we look through Scripture, my hope is that God will reveal the truth to you, that we will rely on God's Word to guide us, and that the Holy Spirit will really open our hearts and minds to who He is as our sovereign God. Turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 9. We'll be looking at Romans chapter 9. Specifically 14 through 18. As a church, we've been going through the book of Romans in a series called The Relentless Grace of the King. We've covered the crisis of man in Romans chapter 1 and 3. We covered the justification on chapters 4, that God has declared those who receive Christ to be made righteous based on what Jesus has done in his righteousness. Listen to Elder Lester and Eric preach on sanctification, death to life, that we are a work in progress, and really to sanctify means to, but we are set apart for a special purpose and use, and that we are being sanctified to make holy. That as followers of Christ, we have not yet been made perfect, but we are in that progress until we are with the Lord. So this morning, I've been asked to speak on chapters 9 through 11 of the sovereignty of God. And really, as I look at Scripture, the truth is, I can't cover chapter 9 through 11 in 35 minutes. But as I read through Scripture and I looked at this, God really impressed my heart, chapters 9, verses 14 to 18. And really, chapters 9 through 11, here Paul is the writer of Romans, he's writing to the people, Christians in Rome, and he begins a three-chapter subject on the nation of Israel, explaining their spiritual condition. Chapter 9 talks about Israel's past spiritual condition. Chapter 10 talks about Israel's present condition. And chapter 11 talks about Israel's future spiritual condition. The sovereignty of God. Let's read 14 to 18, and I'm reading from the English Standard Version. What shall we say then? Is there injustice on God's part? By no means. Let's stop there for a minute. What then shall we say? Is God unjust? Not at all. Again, earlier I talked about that questions about who can be saved. Who can we choose to be saved? Why are certain things in our lives have occurred? And here, Paul begins with a firm statement and says, there's no injustice or impartiality with God. Now, before we even go into the verse 15, for us to understand this firm statement that Paul is saying, that there's no injustice on God's part, we have to look at verses 11 through 13. So let's turn there. 11 through 13 says, I'm sorry, 10, starting 11, yes. Though they were not yet born and had done nothing either good or bad, in order that God's purpose of election might continue, not because of works, but because of him who calls, she was told, the older will serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob I have loved, but Esau I hated. Paul begins in chapter 9 And then when you look at chapter 9, he says, I anguish and I'm in great sorrow for my people, the Israelites, his Jewish people. And here he's explained to them that most of his people have rejected the cornerstone, who is Jesus Christ. They rejected him and crucified him. And so then he begins to tell them in verse 6 that I'm in sorrow, I'm in anguish. And then in verse 6 it says, but it is not as though the word of God has failed. Yet most of his people, the nation of Israel, rejected Christ. He says, the word of God has not failed. And then he continues and says, for not all who are descended from Israel belong to Israel, and not all are children of Abraham because they are his offspring. But through Isaac shall your offspring be named. And so if you guys remember the Old Testament and how God specifically brought Abraham, who became Abraham, and told him that through him that he will be blessed and his people will be blessed. And here God's word does not fail, but he continues to be faithful. Abraham, now through Isaac, we know Isaac had a brother, Ishmael. But out of there, God continued to be faithful in his promise through Isaac. And now he says in verse 9, though they were not yet born, because who had kids? Isaac had kids with Rebekah. And here, Paul begins to make the statement that God is not impartial in choosing Jacob. And what did he say? Though they were not yet born and had done nothing either good or bad. So you have to see, Jacob and Esau did not do anything to persuade God's decision. But what did he say? It says, in order that God's purpose of election, the word election in Greek is eklege, meaning chosen, choice. In order that God's purpose of election might continue. Not because of works, but because of him who calls. You see, God's choice to choose Jacob over Esau, he did that way before they were born. And that wasn't because of what they had done. You see, his reason of choosing Jacob is this, that God's purpose of election might continue. God wanted election to stand not because of works, not because of what Esau has done or whose parents are or how much they worship God or how faithful Rebekah was to pray for Esau or Jacob. No, the truth is this. Election is based on him, based on God who calls. And really, God is free and independent in choosing Jacob over Esau. There's nothing that we can do to persuade God's decision and what he plans and want to fulfill, whether in our lifetime or in our children's lifetime. And that's why Paul was saying, is there any justice in God's part? By no means. By no means. In 1964, my dad, Romulo Soy, came to know the Lord Jesus Christ through a Southern Baptist missionary from Odessa, Texas. And I still remember my dad telling me a story. He came to Winnowan Baptist Church, half drunk. He didn't grow up with a dad. His dad served in the army, but his dad passed away when he was 7. Had a hard time growing up. And he came in the back of the pew, and the missionary was preaching the word of God and the gospel, and he was able to hear. And the truth is, God, out of his great mercy, chose to save my dad. Chose to bring that missionary at that moment in time. And in that process, my dad began to grow in the Lord, and he was praying over the beach one day, because we lived by the ocean in the Bhutan. And at that moment, God began to break his heart for the people of the Philippines. Now you have to understand, God choosing my dad at that moment in time is so significant because God allowed certain things to happen. God broke his heart for the people of the Philippines, and he saw the need of the people of the Philippines to hear the gospel, to have a savior. From that moment on, God took my dad and took on to be part of his kingdom movement in the Philippines, starting churches there and in California. And I still remember when we would go to different revivals, different marketplaces where we're meeting Filipinos. He would always say this. He would always say this in Tagalog. He says, "Wala nang magmamahal sa ating Pilipino kung hindi tayo mga kapwa Filipino." And now it's his heartbeat for our people group. That he believed that no one can reach another Filipino more than we can. Last July, my dad was diagnosed with cancer, stage 4, called squamous cell carcinoma. You see, we prayed and prayed, and he prayed and prayed that God would heal him, and we truly believed that. So 2 months later, as we got the result from the CAT scan and X-ray, the cancer grew even bigger. And so the church gathered and prayed again, and we truly believed that God could heal him. But the cancer even grew even bigger and bigger, to the point where the doctors basically told our family that there's nothing we could do. And so at this moment, the last 3 months of my dad's life was hard. His hair was gone, he was a shell of himself. He couldn't do what he was passionate about, was to serve his congregation. He couldn't walk. And I still remember driving from San Francisco to Stockton, which was 2 hours away, visiting my dad, and seeing him in agony and in pain. And the truth is, there were times where when I sought God for prayer that I questioned God's sovereignty. Why would God choose to allow my dad, who have served him faithfully, to have cancer and through all this pain? And I still remember talking to my dad in the hospital. And he even said, "James, son, I don't understand." But he never wavered in trying to question what God is doing. Yes, he didn't understand, but his faith did not waver. And he would bring us together and remind us of our calling as a family in California and the United States. And he would remind us that out of God's mercy, God called him, rescued him, brought our family here. In the last few days of his life, I would always see a picture of him telling the nurses and the doctors that it's a win-win situation for him. As he faced death, he would remind them and tell them about his story in the Lord. And then remind them that either God will heal him and that God will be glorified, or that he will go home with the Lord. And he will always say, "I will zoom to the glory." You see, church, God allowed those to happen. And there's times I question it, but as I look at who God is, and as I look at Scripture, there was nothing that I can do that can change God's plan. Because it is He who decides. He is free and independent in choosing what He desires. Now that we've learned that God chose Jacob for the purpose of election might continue, and that again, election stands not because of works or what Esau or what Jacob has done. that he's free and independent in choosing Jacob over Esau. Let's look at the topic of his mercy. And really, when we think about God's mercy, we automatically think grace, right? And many people get this mixed up. Really, I've got it mixed up many times as well. Although they're close in meaning, they're not the same thing. Grace is God's unmerited favor, and it goes beyond mercy. Grace is God's unmerited favor, and it goes beyond mercy. And mercy is God not giving us the punishment that we deserve for our sins. Okay, in the very beginning, as God created the heavens and the earth, and he created Adam and Eve, sin entered humanity, and we were separated from God. And that separation is due because God is holy and righteous, and our sin separated us. And because of our sins, when the Bible says, for all that fall short of the glory of God, we are condemned and headed towards destruction. And here Paul continues to answer why God chose Jacob and why he's not unjust. What does he say in verse 15? He says, for he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. That is a very difficult pill to swallow. If you are a follower of Christ, and God says, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. And he gives him a reason from verse 16 why he will have compassion and mercy on whoever. It says in verse 16, what does it say? It says, so then it depends not on human will or exertion, but on God who has mercy. When God decides to have mercy on whoever he wants, it's not because of what we have done. It's not what because of who you are. You've been to First Philippine for 30, 40 years, or you've planted churches, or you've shared the gospel and discipled 100 people, or have been good. There's nothing on our part that influences or persuades God's plan of having compassion on someone or having mercy on someone. It's based on his mercy. And so Paul continues in verse 17. He says, out of his mercy, for the scripture says to Pharaoh, and he uses Pharaoh as an illustration, for this very purpose I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you, and that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. You see, God's purpose of showing us mercy and choosing whomever, really, for the purpose of what? That his power might be seen in our lives. That his power might be seen in our tragedies, in our heartaches, in our blessings, in our church, in our victories, or even our defeats. His power is manifested in them. Not only does he do this out of his, so that his power is seen, what did it say there? That my name, not First Philippines, not you, not our denomination, his name might be proclaimed in all the earth. And so when he chose Jacob because he had a plan that out of Jacob, his name will be proclaimed in all the earth. And if you think about it, we're not even part of the heritage of the Jewish nation. We are Gentiles. If you're not fully Jewish today, you're a Gentile. We are adopted into God's family. Out of his mercy, he adopted us. Not because of who we are as a Filipino or Americans or whatever nationality you are. He's out of his mercy. In 18, Paul continues, says, so then, he, God, who has mercy, on whom he will have mercy on whomever he wills, and he hardens whomever he wills. In verse 19, Paul says, "You will say to me then, why does he still find fault if he decides who has mercy and will have compassion?" And Paul gets this eloquent response, says, "For who can resist his will? But who are you? Who are we? O man," answer back to God, "well, what is molded say to his molder? Why have you made me like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out of the same lumps one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? What if God, desiring to show his wrath, to make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for the glory? Even us, whom he has called, not from the Jews, but also from the Gentiles." You see, who are we as God's creation to question, to dictate, or even to say, "God, you are unjust"? There's a story in Luke 18:35 to 43 and Luke 17:11 to 19. If you could turn your Bibles there, I didn't put it up there. Hopefully, you brought your Bibles. And here, Jesus has a similar encounter with different people where he heals them, one from leprosy, one from blindness. And in Luke 17, it says, if you're there, say amen, so I'll begin. All right. "On the way to Jerusalem, he was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at the distance and lifted up their voices, saying, 'Jesus, Master, have mercy on us.' When he saw them, he said to them, 'Go and show yourselves to the priests.' And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And when he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, 'We're not 10 cleansed, we're the 9. Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?' And he said to them, 'Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well.'" Here, as Jesus is walking, and here he meets these group of individuals with leprosy. And I don't know if you ever studied or looked up leprosy. It's one of the worst diseases anyone could ever have. And you see, these lepers were exiled. They were marginalized. They were shunned by the Jewish community. No one wanted to do anything with them at all. And as Jesus was passing by, what did they do? They stood at a distance and they lifted up their voices saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Have mercy on us." You see, they understood who they were before God, before Jesus Christ. They understood where they were in their lives. They were not relying on who they were or what they've done. They were just relying on God's mercy. So they had this great faith of just believing, if God is merciful, if Jesus is merciful, he will heal us. And as we read the story, one came back and gave honor and glory to God. Only one. And in Luke 18, here Jesus heals a blind beggar. As he drew near to Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. And hearing a crowd going by, he inquired what this meant. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." And he cried out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And those who were in front rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and commanded him to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" He said, "Lord, let me recover my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Recover your sight. Your faith has made you well." And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him, glorifying God and all the people. And when they saw it, they praised to God. Do you understand these 10 lepers, these blind beggars. God allowed them from the very beginning to go through this. Out of His great sovereignty, He allowed them to be blind, to have leprosy, for the purpose so that His power, you may not agree with it, but this is not, God doesn't need your approval. He doesn't need our approval. He said, by His power, so people will know His power. And in these, this blind beggar came up, again, knowing that he was in need. And he called out, Son of David. You have to understand the context. He's blind. So he's going, Son of David, Son of David. He's just trying to walk and figure out where Jesus is. And then the people began saying, hey, get out of here, get out of here. Did he quit? No. He was relying upon God's mercy, and he shouted even more. And out of God's great mercy, Jesus healed him. And then what does the text say? As he was healed, what happened next? He glorified God. God's power was seen in his life. And then what did the people begin to do? They saw it and gave praise to God. Jesus' name was proclaimed in the city. You think they kept that a secret? No way. The gospel spread. As I close, Ephesians 2, 4, and 5 is one of my favorite verses. And if you haven't underlined this, you should. It says, but God, and I want to stop there. Because I want us to really put ourselves in this, in these verses. I want you to look back in your life before you encountered the living God. I want you to look back in your life where you were down and out, when your marriage was in the rocks, where your life displayed the world, where you were broken and scarred from past hurts, and truly you were just lost and hopeless. Maybe you had a great house, a great job, but the truth is, you were hopeless. You were still looking for love in the wrong places. You thought you could find it in a man and a woman and a job and your money, or going to America will find happiness and purpose in your life. But the truth is, before you met the living God, you were hopeless. And so look at this verse. It says, but God. You see, God had a plan for me. God had a plan for you. God had a plan for my dad. God had a plan for our people. And what was that plan? But God being rich in mercy, church. Being rich in mercy. It's mercy. Because of the great love with which He loved us. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, even when we were still just filthy rags, even when we just put our lives first and our money first and our careers first, and we've done so many things wrong before God's eyes that we didn't feel worthy to even come to church because our life was just full of lies and deceptions and sin. He says here, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. By God's His mercy. I'm here today because of His great mercy. And I thank God that He chose to save my dad in 1964. Because I don't know where my life would be now. Our family. R.C. Sproul, great theologian and pastor, says, it's a little small, but I'll read it. We asked about being fair, and I don't think God owes it to anyone who doesn't want Christ to give them the desire to want what they need. He doesn't owe that to anybody. The problem is this, that if God does it for some, why doesn't He do it for all? I can only say to you that I have no idea why He doesn't do it for all. But this I know, and I ask you to think about it carefully. Just because he does it for some, and in no way requires that he do it for everybody else. Because grace is never required. God always reserves this prerogative, I will have mercy upon whom I will have mercy. Church, it's not up to us to direct God's mercy. And the great Charles Spurgeon said this. He says, I believe the doctrine of election, because I'm quite sure that if God had not chosen me, I should have never chosen him. And I'm sure he chose me before I was born, or else he would never have chosen me afterwards. And lastly, John Piper said, the wisdom of God has to ordain a way for the love of God to deliver us from the wrath of God without compromising the justice of God. Who will be saved? Did we choose to be saved? Why are some not saved? Why did this tragedy have to happen in my life? These are questions that we're going to wrestle with. In believing in God's sovereignty. As a church, how do we respond to these questions? You mentioned that you prayed for a pastor for 2.5 years. God allowing these pastors to move on to serve him in other places was God's plan. And I'm pretty sure most of you guys are saying, man, that's no good. You weren't happy with that decision. You weren't happy with what was happening in FPBC. But the truth is, that was in God's plan. There's going to be times in our life that we're going to face trials, storms, where God allows things to happen in our church, in our families, as you as an individual. Will you continue to trust in God's sovereignty in your life? Will you continue to trust in his great mercy? The bottom line is this. By God's mercy, church, he opened our eyes to the truth and elected to rescue us from death. By his great mercy, he opened your eyes and my eyes to the gospel of Jesus Christ, to my need of a Savior, to my dire need to be saved from my sins, and chose us, chose to rescue me, chose to rescue you from death. That's the God we serve. As young people, if you're young here today, when I say young, maybe just high school, because if you're like have been 21, you're really old. Young people, as you continue to follow God and maybe search for who he is in your life, are you going to continue to trust in what he has planned for you? Or are you going to say, I'm going to do it my way. I have a plan. Or are you going to rely on his word and see that he has this great plan for you? Or maybe some of you guys here who are married, and maybe there's things in your marriage that's not all great, and you're searching for answers, and maybe there's things in the past that occurred that are difficult to continue. Are you going to come together as God's people, as he brought you together, to continue to trust him? And trust in his great mercy that he's brought you together for a plan and a great purpose. FPBC, imagine if we as a church truly relied on God's sovereignty in our lives and what he's doing here. And that as we walk and follow him, Eric, that we are reminded and continually humbled by His great mercy, that no matter the great things we've done for Him, that does not dictate God's decision what He will do. But we continually have faith in who He is and trust Him in the process that He's planning, because He has a great, amazing plan for FPBC. He's in a great, amazing plan for us to be used in the city of Houston. And Scripture already says He's moving and working, convicting your relatives' hearts, your co-workers' hearts, your neighbors' hearts. Will you just trust and believe that God is sovereign, and out of your faithfulness and obedience to Him, go and make disciples. Go and share your story to your neighbor. Go and pray for someone at work who's struggling in their marriage, or struggling financially, or going through some hard times. You see, the bottom line is this: by God's mercy, He opened our eyes to the truth. If we know that truth, then we ought to take it to the nations. We ought to take it to our families. We ought to take it with our best friends who do not know Christ. We ought to take it to our neighbors who are Muslims, Hindus, Buddhists, or atheists, or agnostics, and believe and trust that God has a plan for their lives. As we sing this last song, I want us to meditate on how much God loves us, how great His mercy is. And if God is speaking to you, I'll be right in the back to pray for you. Pastor D's here. You want to come to him, he'll pray for you. Brother Eric, we have many pastors. Don't miss out the opportunity. If God is speaking to you and the Holy Spirit is guiding you, to come to us so that we can pray with you. And maybe he's opened your eyes to the truth of who He is. And you've gone to church so many times, but the gospel is presented well today, and you understand who God is now. Help us guide you to knowing who Jesus is. Because if He is opening your eyes, He's choosing you today. And that is a great thing. Let's do that now.